the book of Matthew. Remember, this is a word of worship, and today is our worship service. So we share a word of worship, and then we will have continuous praise and worship to the end of the service. So there is no word coming after this. So take your pen, take your paper, on a book. We want to share on the presence of God. That is the topic of the word that we're going to share, the presence of God, the presence of God. It's a word that God gave me on Tuesday, and that word has come so heavy in my heart. I shared partly on Wednesday from the book of Matthew chapter 7 from verse 21 to 24, but Matthew chapter 7 from 21 through 27 is the finishing point of the Sermon on the Mountain. And one of the words that touched me there, the Bible says, "He who listens to my word," Jesus Christ says, "He who listens to my word and keeps them is like a wise builder who has built his house on a solid foundation." So he who listens unto the Lord's teaching. Now, I was asking myself, what are these teachings that Jesus is talking about? And if you go, you start from chapter 5, chapter 6, chapter 7, to chapter 7, verse 27, you realize that Jesus has addressed the morals or the Christian character, the morals and the ethics, and the application of every word that he speaks. Actually, that is one of the five continuous messages that he speaks. The rest of the passages, if you read through the book of Matthew, Jesus is either healing or addressing his disciples. But where he's addressing everybody and addressing our spiritual walk is the longest part of it is in Matthew chapter 5 through chapter 7. Please, I urge you, go through it. I read, I don't know how many times throughout the week, every day I read through all those three chapters and noted down every single thing that, because those are instructions. Jesus speaks and he actually addresses the law. He addresses Christian character and he addresses so many things. He actually even addresses the kingdom of God. And he finishes by saying that, blessed are these people who will hear my word. These people who will listen to my word and keep them are like a wise builder that has built his house on a rock. So that means that our walk, as long as we are walking in salvation, depends on the very word that Jesus has mentioned from chapter 5, chapter 6, and it finishes with chapter 7, verses 27. So please, at your personal time, find time and go through it. I've gone through it, I don't know how many times, those three chapters, repeating and repeating, to pick every single word. The Bible says, "Not everyone that calls me Lord, Lord, that will see heaven, except those who do my will." Praise the Lord. That is a very strong word that should not be taken lightly. He said that some will come to me and they will say to me, "We did miracles in your name." Some will come to him and say to him that we healed in your name. We prophesied in your name. But he will tell them, "Go away from me." And if you read the book of that very verse or chapter using NLT, it says, "For the work you are doing was unauthorized." In other words, I didn't give you permission to do what you did. Praise the Lord. So it is until that you and me do the will of the Father that we will make it. Actually, before then, he says, still chapter 7, he says that narrow is the way to the Father, and very few will make it. But broader is the way that goes to hell. So hell is real. Heaven is real. People are going to hell. People are going to heaven. Jesus has said so. It is upon us to choose as believers, as sons of God, as sons in the kingdom, people of the light, to walk by the principles that are guiding this kingdom. Praise the Lord. By the kingdom principles. So every morning when I wake up, I want to look at any single thing that I'm doing. When I program my day, when I do whatever I'm doing, I should do it according to the word of God. I should do it according to the principles of God. And it comes to character. It has been listed there. Whatever I'm supposed to do, whatever character I'm supposed to have as a believer, I ought to purpose to walk through that very character. By the grace of God, the Spirit of God dwells in us. Let's keep on praying and seeking Him. He will perfect us. Praise the Lord. So let's go to the book of Matthew chapter 18, verses 20. Matthew chapter 18, verses 20. Because our time is limited, I will read, and most of the scriptures I will just quote, and you read at your personal time. Matthew chapter 18, verses 20. The Bible says, "For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there, that I am in the midst of them." The Bible says, "For where two or three are gathered in my name," remember we are sharing on the presence of God. He says that where two or three are gathered for my name's sake, I'm in their presence, I'm in their midst. So the Lord is in this place. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So the presence of God is in this place. We are more than two. We are more than three. We are gathered for the name of the Lord. So the presence of God is with us today. Wherever two or three are gathered in my name's sake, I am in their midst. Now, if this is a place of God, if this is a place where the presence of God is, then we need to look at how in the Old Testament, because those people that were written down as history in the Bible, they are supposed to guide us to know how did the people of the old approach the presence of God. We have come to the presence of God. We are gathered for the purpose of our fellowship. We are gathered for the purpose of worshiping God. Now, how should we approach the presence of God? Praise the Lord. Because we know now that God is with us. We are not calling Him to come. The Bible says that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, 1 Corinthians 3:16. So we house Him. We house the government of God. We house God the Father. We house God the Son. Wherever we are in a marketplace, wherever we are, whatever we are doing, we house the presence of God always with us as believers. And now that we are here in the presence of God, how should we come to the presence of God? If you read Exodus chapter 3 from 5, but you can start from verse 1, we hear the story of Moses and the burning bush. Now, Moses saw a burning bush. He was taking care of the flock of his father-in-law on the mountain. And the Bible says, and Moses saw a burning bush. And when the angel saw that he has drawn attention of Moses, now Moses decided to draw near to see what is happening to this burning bush. And the Bible says, and God and the voice of God spoke to Moses and said, that listen, Moses, remove your sandals, for the place where you are standing is a holy ground. Praise the Lord. The Bible says that Moses was told, that remove your sandals, for the place where you are standing is a holy ground. Moses was approaching the presence of God. He never knew that he's approaching the presence of God. He only saw a burning bush. But out of the burning bush, the Bible says, and a voice spoke and he said, now Moses, as you approach the presence of God, you are already in the holy place. Please remove your sandals. Praise the Lord. Sandals then, when we are talking about shoe or sandals, And then when someone removed them, it signifies authority, and that as surrender. It simply means that you have honored that very place by removing your sandals. You have honored that particular place by removing your sandals. So the sandals are mentioned here are sandals that to signify honor, to signify that respect, the honor for that particular place. Praise the Lord. But today it is not about the shoe, because the Bible says the veil of the temple has ruptured. We are no longer operating on the outside. We are now operating in the Holy of Holies. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews, Christ has already gone in and he has become a high priest and he has made us priests. Praise the Lord. The Bible says we no longer need a priest to offer a burning sacrifice to the Lord for the remission of our sin. Christ has already taken, Christ has already opened the veil when he died on the cross, and the curtain of the temple that was separating the holy to the holy of holies, that temple curtain ruptured, and we were asked that the Holy of Holies was exposed. So today, we are not talking about the physical shoes, the physical clothing, but we are talking about our spirit. Praise the Lord. So in the spirit, there could be some hindrances. There could be some other things that are standing that we need to do. And by doing so, we show our honor, our respect to God. Praise the Lord. Another, if you read also in the book of Joshua chapter 5, verses 13 through verses 15. Joshua chapter 5, verses 13 to verses 15. Now Joshua has encountered with a man. A man has a sword. And the Bible says, and Joshua approached this man. And he asked, are you for us, or are you against us, or are you for our enemies? And the man said, neither. Praise the Lord. And he said, now, Joshua, remove your shoe, for the place where you are standing is a holy ground. So what we realize is, whenever God sets his feet, whenever God comes, that place becomes a holy place and it needs to be honored. Praise the Lord. Because, you know, where Moses was, that was a place where perhaps other people were taking their flock to feed. It was just a mountain. But by the fact that the presence of God is at that particular time, the place, the ground has become holy. Perhaps Moses had passed through the same place grazing his flock. But the Bible says, and God spoke and he said, the place where you are standing is a holy ground. The time of Joshua, perhaps Joshua had used the same place. But now the Bible says when he was drawing near, God told him, remove your shoe, for the place where you are standing is a holy ground. Praise the Lord. Amen. Exodus chapter 19 verse 21. The Bible says, Exodus 19, 21. They just wanted to hear the voice of God. They began to murmur, how come that it is only you that God is going to speak to? The Israelites were speaking to Moses. And God told Moses, go tell these people to sanctify themselves so that they can approach me. Tell them to go clean up themselves, sanctify themselves. And they went, they washed clothing, they did whatever they did, but they forgot to prepare themselves to come to the presence of God. So the same place where they were supposed to come, where they're supposed to approach Mount Sinai, it was just a mountain. But by the fact that the Lord had already identified the place, and it was a place where he would come and speak to Moses, that place was rendered a holy ground. Praise the Lord. So this is not just a house. Where we are is a holy ground. Hallelujah. We have not come to meet any man. The presence of God is here. Praise the Lord. So God is with us. Number two, this is a holy ground. Praise the Lord. Now, in this holy ground, we can receive our miracles. And in this holy ground, God can reject us. Praise the Lord. We can receive our miracle from this holy ground. And at the same time, from this holy ground, we can be rejected. We can go home with a curse. From this holy ground, we can go home with a curse. Let's go to the book of Hebrews, chapter 12. I will read that part. If you get there quickly, read. Thank you, Jesus, for your presence. Hebrews 12, 28, 29. Anyone? Let me read. The Bible says, therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Verse 29, for our God is a consuming fire. Anyone with which is this translation? NIV, yeah. I wanted to mention NIV. Anybody with NIV? Read?
Verse
29. 28, 29, chapter 12.
Since you have received a kingdom that is unshakable, let us be thankful and please God by worshipping Him with holy fear and hope. For our God is dwelling fire.
Praise the Lord. So in this very chapter, the Bible says, okay, other translations say, let's give our services acceptably to God. NIV, NLT, and some translation say, let us give our worship, acceptable worship to God, in reverence and in awe, trembling. Praise the Lord. So, if we already know that this is a holy ground, now the Bible says that when we come to Him in worship, when we come to His presence, when we come to the place where God speaks, then we need to come to Him in awe and in reverence. If we lift our arms to worship, if we bow to worship Him, we need to do it in awe and in reverence. Praise the Lord. It has to be an acceptable sacrifice. And an acceptable sacrifice is a sacrifice that is done according to the will of God. God is not interested by how many things are we able to do. How graced are we? Maybe with good voices. Maybe how many cows that God has blessed us with. How many sacrifices can we bring to the altar? But God now is looking at who is this man that is willing to bring to me an acceptable sacrifice according to my principles. When I was reading that the Sermon on the Mountain, the guidelines that have been given there, you know, it made me tremble. Praise the Lord. I was trembling because Jesus finishes by making so strong statements. He says that, yes, people will call unto me, but not everyone will call unto me will see the kingdom. That means there are people that will call unto me and they will not make it to the kingdom. But except those who do the will of the Father, those who are doing the very thing that I have instructed them to do. In other words, there are hindrances that will stand between us and our miracle. There are some hindrances that will stand between us and giving this acceptable sacrifice to God. And these are the entrances I want us to look at. You know, Cain went to give gifts. The Bible says, and Abel also went to give his gifts. So both of them gave gifts. Abel gave gifts. Cain also brought his gifts to God. They all bound to, before the Lord. Only that Cain's gifts were not received, and Abel's gifts were received. Both of them were in the presence of God. Both of them were offering a sacrifice. But the Bible says, Abel chose what was the best and he offered to God. And the Bible says, Cain chose anyhowly. He never cared what I'm going to give. He never bothered or wondered. He looked at Isaac as a burden. He only did it as a religious act, if I may. I use that word. He only do it because he was familiar to it. It was a culture. So he did as a culture. But Abel went before the Lord with the best of his flock. Praise the Lord. Amen. So both of them gave gifts. And the same God in his presence, he accepted Abel's gifts. and Cain's gifts were not accepted. At the end of the day, Cain kills Abel. As if it is Abel that was to make the sacrifice to be acceptable to God. You know, sometimes hatred, we hate people. We struggle with other people just because when they go to the presence of God, we are seeing miracles happening, and as it's not happening, and we're pushing them to the corner, trying to rob whatever God has placed in them, trying to bring them down to our level so that we can be equal. But we need to understand that all of us are presenting ourselves before the presence of God. We have understood that today this is the holy ground. We have understood today that the presence of God is here. Amen. And the Bible has said to Moses, he said, remove your sandal. To Joshua, he said, remove your sandal. To the children of Israel, he said, prepare yourself as you come to the holy ground to give your sacrifice. Amen. And to us, the church, especially the church of Bethel today, God is saying, prepare yourself before you come to my presence. Give an acceptable sacrifice. Acceptable sacrifice that is given in awe and in reverence. So what are these hindrances? Number one, familiarity. Familiarity. We've read, or I've only mentioned chapter 7 of Matthew, verse 21 through verses 24. The Bible says, accept those who do the will of my Father. Jesus says in John chapter 5, verses 19, the Son can do nothing except what he sees the Father do. The Son was God, and he never did anything except what he saw the Father do. Praise the Lord. So in other words, for our sacrifices to be acceptable to God, whether in worship, whether in praises, whether in whichever way we are doing, it has to be in line with the will of God. Praise the Lord. Familiarity. The word familiar comes from a Latin word. Latin word means household. That familiar word comes from a Latin word means, which means household. It simply means one of my household. For example, we are all members in Bethel. We can become so familiar to one another, we can, you know, because we are too familiar, I expect some honor, some respect from you. Praise the Lord. I expect you to honor my opinion. We are familiar. And that familiarity, the spirit of familiarity, has broken many marriages, because couples are so familiar to one another. Nobody bothers to perform his duties because the Bible has clearly stipulated what is supposed to be done by who, even in a marriage. He said, even yes, I know you're one. Woman submit, man love, praise the Lord. But because of the familiar spirit, many have not taken that into consideration. And the marriages are breaking. Employees in a company, bosses don't respect their juniors. Juniors don't respect their bosses because of the familiar spirit. Because they take a cup of tea together. They are so used to one another, the familiar spirit. So when the boss asks them to come early to work, they don't come early to work because, I'll find that boss, I'll buy him a cup of tea somewhere else and we'll finish this. At least, your boss wachana will handle wachana ngangana na something else. So he goes on doing his own duty, he's paid to do some duty, he's supposed to be at work at that particular time. And at the end of the day, the company begins to fall because of the familiar spirit. Praise the Lord. That's why if you go to most of these corporate entities, you know, a CEO, it's not very easy for a CEO to mingle with the other employees. He will come, instruct, and then he will go. He will call upon people of his level, They will sit and discuss. Employees will be greeted. If there is anyone that needs to be appreciated, will be appreciated. And if you see him, you'll see him on a personal capacity, under personal capacity, not within the company. Because as long as he's within the company, what they're trying to do is to avoid that familiarity. Praise the Lord. So even in the presence of God, as children of God, many of us are not receiving our miracles. Many of us are not receiving our promises that God has promised because of the familiar spirit. We have become so familiar that I would want to speak any way the Lord has not spoken to me. But I want to speak anyway because I know God wants to speak it. So I'll speak. This is what the Lord is saying, even when the Lord has not said. Familiar spirit. I know that God is going to speak anyway. Praise the Lord. It comes to worship, you know, when others are lifting their hands, when others are struggling to give that perfect sacrifice that is acceptable to God, you don't care. Move out, yes, you want, because it's a familiar place. Anyway, this is a church. It's guided by, it's headed by Reverend Ann. He has got pastors and elders. This is a church. Anyway, praise the Lord. I'll see Mount Office to come here. The rest, I don't care. Familiar spirit. That familiar spirit is robbing many their miracles. It's robbing us that grace that God wanted us to receive. It's robbing us that sacrifice. You know, when we come to the presence of God, the last thing that God would want to see is someone coming to him with a familiar spirit. And I will worship God as always. I don't care lifting up my hands. I don't care going on my knees. He is God. Anyway, he said, sometimes it's not even done. Familiar spirit. Matthew chapter 13, verse 54 to 58. The Bible says, Jesus did miracles in his own hometown, and his people marveled. Is it not the son of Joseph? Is it not that son of a carpenter? Where did he get this wisdom from? Matthew chapter 13, from verses 54 to verse 58. And the Bible says, verses 58, that Jesus did not do much in his own hometown. Why? Because they did not believe. To him, he was a son of Joseph. To them, he was a son of Joseph, a son of the carpenter. So the familiar spirit was with them. We are used to this one. Now, what Jesus says that a prophet has no honor in his hometown. Praise the Lord. Familiar spirit. To the Lord help us. He did not do much in his own hometown because they were used to him. So they never saw him as the Messiah. They never saw him as a son of God. They saw him as a son of Joseph. And when they were when he was asking them to come to salvation, they said anyway, you know, some of them were religious people. They knew the law, what the law says. So they stood and quoted what the law was saying. But Jesus is telling them, I am the fulfillment of that law. They could not understand because this is someone that is rising from amongst them. They expected a Messiah that will drop from heaven. But now a time has come, a Messiah has come from one of them. They are questioning that because of the familiar spirit. Familiarity. Praise the Lord. So he did not do much. Leviticus 19:1, you can read at your personal time. By the way, that book of Leviticus chapter 19, if you read it through, some of us think that only God gave the 12 commandments, but there are so many other commandments that God gave. I love verses 32 because it says, when an old man comes, when a gray man comes, you need to stand. Praise the Lord. But now I want to look at, you know, we can also become so familiar that I can sit there and say, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But there are so many instructions that has been given. Now verses 31, the Bible says, give no regard to those with a familiar spirit and those who are consulting mediums. So familiar spirit and those who consult mediums are put in the same group. When you allow this familiar, you know, the familiar spirit is something that is in most of us, and we cannot identify that. It is easier for you to become familiar, because the more you go through that thing, the more you get more experience, the more you prolong your stay in a particular place, you know, you become familiar with that place. If someone tells you to come in this church, for those of us that are in the church almost on a daily basis, when the lights are closed, you can almost tell, this is our toilet without the lights. You can tell this is mom's office, this is other offices, because you're familiar with this place. But when it comes to the presence of God, we need always to check ourselves. There is something that needs to be done. We are approaching the presence of God. We are standing. The Lord is with us here. This is a holy ground. How are we approaching the holy ground? Familiar spirit. John chapter 4 verses 19, 20. You can read at your personal time. The Bible says that this Samaritan woman, Jesus is having a conversation with her. But the Bible says that this Samaritan woman told Jesus, "You people worship in Jerusalem, but our Father worshiped here." Regardless of how she lived, she knew that our Father worshiped here. She perhaps came to worship there because the fathers, Jacob and the rest, came to worship there. Even Jacob had built a well, so they were drawing water from that same well. So she had that familiar spirit. She was used to how the fathers were worshiping. If you come to our land, Kisiland, we have a Kanisa Yoko. Kanisa Yoko. So, someone does not go to church, but his grandmother was going to that church. So, ukimuuliza mimi mkatoliki. He's never gone to Catholic, but ako na kanisa ya uko, hereditary, praise the Lord. So they are familiar. They knew how it's supposed to be done. But Jesus is introducing something. Until Jesus comes to a point, he says that, listen, the hour is coming and the hour is now when true worshippers will worship in spirit and in truth. It is no longer how the Father used to do, but now I have come. The hour is here when people need to worship in spirit and in truth, according to the principles of God, according to the instructions given. So in this holy ground, you can come. But if you come with a familiar spirit, it is easier for you to go home with a curse. And I will show you from scripture why so many people went home with curses. The last thing I would want is to go to a house of God and leave that house of God with a curse. This is the presence of your Father. Your Father is here with us. He says, "My son, say anything and I will do it for you." You have come to worship him. So if there is any entrance that standing between you and your Father, the easiest thing you can do is to get rid of it. That hatred, that malice, that sin that is hidden in you, it is so easy for you to confess rather than you come and live with a permanent curse. Praise the Lord. Familiar spirit. Nathaniel had the same spirit. John chapter 1, verse 43, 46. He's been told, "Come and see. The Messiah is here." But listen to what Nathaniel says. "And anything good comes from Jerusalem." He's so used to Jerusalem. He knows what is happening. So Nathaniel is asking, "Can anything good come from that land?" Familiar spirit. Praise the Lord. May God help us. It's so easy for us to become so familiar on how we worship our God. So familiar. It's so easy for you to pray and pray and pray and become familiar on how you pray. It's so easy for you to go to the presence of God now and then until you become familiar. There are people who say that, "I know what God wants to say even before he says it." So they say what they think what God would have spoken. That is a familiar spirit. And the Bible says, cursed is the man that says the Lord has said, and when the Lord has not spoken. Praise the Lord. I'm very careful not to say the Lord has said until the Lord has said. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
This is a holy ground. I'm saying this so that we can get to a point and understand that God loves us. By the way, love is a command to all of us because God has loved us. It's not a request, something that you go and think of. It's a command. Praise the Lord. So God loves you. The Bible says, John 1:12, for those who have been given him, he has given them power to become his sons. And when you become a son in the kingdom, the Bible says, if you men that are evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father? He goes on mentioning the birds of the air, the lilies of the valley. Who takes care of them? Are you not much more important than those lilies of the valley and the birds of the air? Praise the Lord. That's why the Bible says when we come to him, let's come to him with thanksgiving. Hindrance number two. So search yourself. How did you come to the house of God today? Did you come because it's a church anyway? And I mean, it's a Sunday, you need to go to church anyway. And because also mom is taking a roll call. So if I don't go to church, she's going to ask me where was I. But did you come to church to meet with your master? Where two or three are gathered, I'm in their midst. The presence of God is with us. We don't have to call him. In fact, I feel him. We don't have to call him, come Lord, come Lord. He is with us. This is not just a King Rock Road or whatever house, King Rock House. This is a holy ground. The Bible says, when we come to this holy ground, remove your shoe. Your shoe could be familiar spirit. Your shoe could be number two. Zara, we are going to share on unforgiveness. You know, the Bible says there are sins that lead to death, and there are sins that does not lead to death. But I don't want us to go there. So if we only talk about sin, we don't want to generalize it. There are those sins that will lead to death. There are those sins that will hinder you from receiving a miracle from God. And there are those sins that God will hold you accountable, but he will still bless you. Praise the Lord. But there are sins that if you harbor them, if you hide them in your heart, they will become a permanent hindrance to the breakthrough that you are looking for. And number two is unforgiveness. Matthew chapter 5, verses 24. The Bible says, if you come to the house of God with your sacrifice, ready in the altar to give, and realize that there is a brother, there is a sister that you have a grudge against, and you have not made it up with him, leave your sacrifice. Go home, make up with that person, then come and offer your sacrifice. It's a command, it's a principle. When we approach the presence of God, is a principle that guides our acceptable sacrifice. And if it is ignored, then it is possible you will give million shillings in this pulpit and still God overlooks it. It is possible that you offer your sacrifice of praise and worship in this pulpit and still God rejects it. Why? Because in your heart, you had an issue and you did not follow. Remember, Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 through 24. Accept those who do the will of my Father. And the will of the Father is when we approach him with our sacrifices. Number one, we need to make sure that we are clean. We have made ourselves right with God. Unforgiveness will hinder your prayer. Unforgiveness will hinder your sacrifices.
and forgiveness will stand between you. The Bible says, just as he forgave, so forgive. It's a command. We ought to love some people even when they don't deserve to be loved, because it's a command. Praise the Lord. So Matthew chapter 5, 43, 48. I want us to read there. I would ask that to come out, the figure ahead of us. Matthew 5, 43, 48. It's actually the same scripture in Luke 6, 27, 36.
Matthew 5,
43, 48.
43, 48. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? Verse 47. And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? Verse 48. Therefore, you shall be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect.
You shall be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. And he says, love, pray for them, even those who persecute you. Love them, pray for them, so that you may be just like your Father in heaven. So that you may be the sons of your Father in heaven. That is what the Bible says. So for us to be the sons of our fathers in heaven, for us to be called sons of God, he forgave us. He still forgives us. The Bible says, for he reigns both to the sinners, and those that are just. The Bible says, for his sun is rising upon all of us, despite of our weaknesses, despite of our standing faith. He loves all of us, praise the Lord. And the Bible says, just like your Father in heaven, for you to be your sons of the Father in heaven, love. The Bible says, for what good is there if you love only your enemies? Even the Pharisees, tax collectors, do the same thing. Are you in the church today? There's someone you cannot talk to. Please. It's not Julius speaking. The word of God is speaking. Make up with that person before you offer your sacrifice. Otherwise, I will comfortably tell you, carry your Bible and go home. Praise the Lord. That one I'll ask mom. Because what good will it be for you to come, cry before God, lift your hands, pray, jump around, and you go home having not received anything from the presence of the Father? Praise the Lord. Just like our Father in heaven loves everyone. It's a command. We want to offer our sacrifice in praise and worship. That is why we need always to prepare ourselves before Sunday. Prepare yourself in prayer. Prepare yourself in searching yourself before you come to the house of God. If there is anyone you feel like I need to call and make some peace with that person, some people you don't need to forgive them, you know, they are so hard to be forgiven. But the Bible instructs you to do so, because love is a command. It is not something that you're going to think of. Praise the Lord. You know, it is a choice. That is where God has given each one of us a personal freedom, choice to decide. You can decide to come with all the hatred in your heart and go home the same way and complain. The Lord said, this is our year of supernatural outpouring. I've had man prophesy on Wednesday. We were saying that the word of God will be spoken, but the word of God needs a landing point. If your heart, if your soil is not fertile, that seed will not germinate. If your soil, if your place is like that place of a thorny ground, then when the seed falls, it begins to germinate. But because of the many thorns, the hatred, the many things in your heart, many burdens, that very seed is squeezed and cannot produce fruits. Praise the Lord. God loves us, and that's why God is speaking these words to us. Colossians chapter 3, verse 13. You can read it from verse 12. The Bible speaks of love. And the Bible says, if anyone has a complaint against the other, forgive just as your Father in heaven forgave. When you come together, the Bible says, let love be a binding factor. Read that part. Paul gives instruction on how a fellowship should be conducted. Yes, you'll be mtakome kanyagana palenge, but any time you come together for one purpose to serve God, let love be the binding factor. Just as your Father in heaven forgave, so forgive. Mark chapter 11, verse 25. The Bible says, when you stand to pray, forgive anything that you may have against anybody, so that your prayers will be answered. So if you want to come and you want to pray and your answer prayers to be answered, forgive. Praise the Lord. You can read at your personal time. Second Corinthians chapter 2, verse 10, verse 11. The Bible says, forgive so that you do not give room for sin. For the Bible says, for the cunning one to tempt you, forgive. Hebrews 12:15, unforgiveness will cause bitterness. Hebrews 12:15. The psalmist said, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. Praise the Lord. So, I want you to take a minute and ask yourself, I've come to the house of God, will not continue because of time, but I want you to ask, be sincere to yourself, why have I come to the house of God today? Do I have any burden in me that will stand between me and my Father? Do I have anything in me that will stand between me and the Father? Do I have the spirit of unforgiveness, some bitterness in me, and I need to let go so that my sacrifice may be accepted? Praise the Lord. If you do, you have a chance to go to the presence of God and tell God, have mercy on me. He is a faithful God. He is a faithful God. His arms are so open and willing to embrace each one of us and willing to embrace our sacrifices today. Let's rise up.